Good morning, friends. Does it sound like the mic is on? Can you hear it? Okay, good. All right, happy to be with you today. It's a treat to be with you. Today is, we're kind of angling toward the end of October, aren't we? And then there will just be two more months left in 2024. This is the Sunday that we have our familial duty of a quarterly meeting. We've agreed that we would meet once a quarter to review our ministry plan and to have transparency in the matter of our finances and to do our best to show what opportunities are available for each of us outside of our family locations. And that's happening today. Nobody would choose to sit inside for 90 minutes on such a beautiful day, but we've told each other we'll do that. So we have a lunch meeting, a potluck after worship, and we'll respect that 90-minute deadline. Today, our focus, a passage from one of the readings this morning, "My people will be filled with my bounty." The Apostles' Creed clearly says that God's Spirit is gathering a family. It is named the Holy Christian Church or the Communion of Saints. How can an individual become part of this family? Think of two trains heading in opposite directions, two tracks, a door open in each. There'll be one moment where they are directly opposite one another. Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. Faith, trust, is called for now. So we'll hear those scripture readings this morning. We have a familiar friend today, Word and Sacrament, on page 26. In your red book, and we'll begin by singing 429. Thank you. page 26 in the red hymn book. When you find that, please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I've disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins. And trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, by his authority, I forgive you all your sin in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. For all that we need in life and for the wisdom to use your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord. For the steadfast assurance that nothing can separate us from your love, and for the courage to stand firm against the assaults of Satan and every evil, hear our prayer, O Christ. For the well-being of your holy church in all the world, and for those who offer here their worship and praise, hear our prayer, O Lord. Merciful God, maker and preserver of life, uphold us by your power and keep us in your tender care. The works of the Lord are great and glorious. His name is worthy of praise. Father, hear the prayers of your people. Give us strength to live a life set apart for you. May we receive your gifts with thankful hearts and put them to good and honest use. We ask this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our two scripture readings are located for you in your service folder. The first one from Jeremiah is page 994. These are sweet pictures. Zion is the place where God is. Using Old Testament pictures, we see a welcome panorama, all sorts of weak, weeping, and broken individuals coming home. This is not the section of Jeremiah 31 that is most well known, but we're going to read today at verse 7. This is what the Lord says. Sing with joy for Jacob. Shout for the foremost of the nations. Make your praises heard and say, O Lord, save your people, the remnant of Israel. See, I will bring them from the land of the north and gather them from the ends of the earth. Among them will be the blind, the lame, expectant mothers, women in labor. A great throng will return. They will come with weeping. They will pray as I bring them back. I will lead them beside streams of water on a level path where they will not stumble, because I am Israel's father. Ephraim is my firstborn son. Hear the word of the Lord, O nations, proclaim it in distant coast lands. He who scattered Israel will gather them and will watch over his flock like a shepherd. For the Lord will ransom Jacob and redeem them from the hand of those stronger than they. They will come and shout for joy on the heights of Zion. They will rejoice in the bounty of the Lord, the grain, the new wine, the oil, the young of the flocks and herds. They will be like a well-watered garden, and they will sorrow no more. Then maidens will dance and be glad, young men and old as well. I will turn their mourning into gladness. I will give them comfort and joy instead of sorrow. I will satisfy the priests with abundance. That can only happen when the people were bringing their gifts, because the priests had no income. So they ate what the people brought. So for the priests to have an abundance meant the people were worshiping. I will satisfy the priests with abundance, and my people will be filled with my bounty, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord for us. We'll respond with our psalm for today. It is number 62 in your red hymn book on page 88. We'll listen to the refrain and the psalm tone, and then we'll sing it in a responsive way. Though your riches increase, My salvation and my honor depend on God. Trust in him at all times, O people.
Pour out your hearts to him, for God is all
our Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning. The second scripture reading today is the one that will serve as our sermon meditation. My wish today would be that we could hear this with ears that are hearing it for the first time. It probably is the 100th time for some of you in here, and because it's a short episode, it can just fly by and we think, ho-hum, what time is the game on? If you listen to this like a child would listen to it, I think there will be benefit here for you. This is Mark chapter 10. We've been in Mark chapter 10 for weeks and weeks and weeks. This is the end of it, verse 46. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, that is, son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him, told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. This is the word of the Lord for you. We respond, "Praise be to you, O Christ." The hymn of the day is 366. Thank you. people of God, I would like it if you could play along with a little game here and use that illustration that I gave you before. Think of a set of train tracks running off into the far distance. And then 20 feet away, think of a second train track. Let's make it even a little bit closer than 20 feet. A second train track, and it goes into the far distance the other way. There's a train on each track. They're heading toward each other. They're not in danger of collision because they're on different tracks. So you have one train rattling along going west and one train rattling along going east, and they each have a boxcar with the door open. So the illustration is that there's going to be one brief moment where they are passing each other with their open boxcar doors facing each other. That's what I have in the back of my mind when I read this scripture. It's not particularly long, and it certainly isn't involved. It doesn't take much explaining to say, did you catch this? The writers, this is mentioned in three of the New Testament Gospels. The writers mention that this is in the city of Jericho. That's down in the rift. If any of you have ever traveled in the West and seen some of the big canyons that there are. In Israel, the land falls off sharply east of Jerusalem, and down at the bottom of that rift is a plain, a flat spot, and the Jordan River's down there. That's why it's really not much good for agriculture in the rest of the country, because the water's way down below. Jericho's down there, not too far north of the Dead Sea. Jesus is coming through Jericho, and then it's 17 miles. You remember this is 17 miles of switchbacks to get up to Jerusalem. All kinds of Bible stories have to do with that trip east out of Jerusalem and the drop down to Jericho. Okay, so there is a blind man in the city of Jericho. And Jesus and his entourage, his posse, are moving through. You know, when we think of someone traveling down a street, you might think of Dodge Street. Well, if you've been in a Middle Eastern city, sometimes the streets are no wider than this, between this step and the bench here. And they twist and turn according to the geography, the topography of the where they are. They go up, they go down, you go down a few steps, you make sudden right or left turns. So you don't have to think about a parade on Dodge Street. But Jesus is with a group. A group is traveling with him, and there is a man who is at the edge of town, where the road goes outside of a gate. Remember what a gate was? It wasn't just the gate like you have on your fence in the backyard, but a gate was like a police station. It was really a small fort. Everywhere that the road went out of the city, there was a big building built up over the top of it, which could be defended. And then you can guess that because the gates were so important, people gathered there. The pop-up shops and restaurants, the taco trucks would have been there outside of the gate. That's where people conducted business. That's where there was a bazaar. People would come up with a backpack or a blanket roll their blanket out, sit down, empty their backpack out of their brass candlesticks, and you'd have a sale. So the gates were where you went if you wanted to see what was happening, if you wanted to get a bite to eat. And naturally, the stories about Jesus entering the big gates of Jerusalem or going out the gate to his crucifixion, it becomes more colorful if you understand that these were large buildings with a hole cut in them. And there was a blind man who was parked outside of the gate that went toward Jerusalem. Did he hobble there by himself? Did he have a white cane? I don't see him so often anymore, but sometimes I still do. Someone with a white cane tapping on the sidewalk, seeing where the step goes down, tapping the curb to see where the step goes up. Or did someone lead him there by the hand? He is hoping for mercy from some kind soul, from some believer perhaps. You've heard of the beggars sitting outside the temple gates. This wasn't at the temple. This was a long way from the temple. And he hears a hubbub. This man who can't work, who can't run, who can't ride a bike, who can't get a job because of his broken body, right? His body is broken. Some, many have said that your eyes are the most profound organ of your body. It's not worth arguing about, but think of what your eye, how God has designed the eye and how it enriches your life and enables you to interpret the world around you. You can live without your eyes, can't you? But what would today, how would today be different if you didn't have them? So this man is blind. That becomes a burden for a believer, right? Because Satan always puts the question, W-H-Y, in our minds. Why me? Why this? Why don't you change it, God? You who can do things with a word, why don't you make my life better? Why don't you relieve my suffering? Why? That question of why is always skating on thin ice for a believer. Once you start letting that get its hook in you, it'll be like burrs in your sock. It'll travel with you wherever you go. So it's a burden. This man has a burden. Not only can he not support himself, but he has, especially a believer, grapples with that question of why. I can't see. I'm not like others. I don't get to share in what others experience day to day. And then on top of it, I have to beg. Begging, I don't need to tell you. You drive into Walmart or Lowe's or McDonald's, and it's very infrequent when there's not someone standing with a sign. And I catch myself thinking, oh, I hope I don't have to make eye contact with this person, depending on what lane I'm in. One gal said to me the other day at one of the senior places, oh, you don't believe those signs, do you? You don't think that those people are really needy, do you? And I, you know, what are you going to say? I don't know. I suppose not everybody is honest. But if you were in a pickle, if you were in a spot, if you weren't around family, if you were in a city where you didn't have people, wouldn't that be a difficult thing? Wouldn't that be really ghastly to have to find a piece of cardboard and borrow a Sharpie from a clerk at a convenience store and scrawl the letters need help or need money for gas? How humiliating to our egos to have to beg. And so this man had his cup or had his coffee can down, and he heard the sound of a conversation's voices, a commotion, the sound of people in a group, and he said, "What's going on? What's happening?" He said to someone around him, and they said, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." Kind of fun to think about is that this is just before the Palm Sunday episode. If you look in your scriptures, that's going to be the next thing that comes up. Even at the end of his ministry, Jesus is still being called Jesus of Nazareth. It's kind of an interesting thing. Not Jesus of Jerusalem or Jesus of Galilee or Jesus of Capernaum where his apartment or house was. Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. The blind man begins to call out. He can't see, but he has ears and he has a voice. And he begins to cry out, "Jesus." You know, the name Jesus is what happens when two languages bump into each other. It started out as Joshua, which I'm sure was a very popular name in Israel. Joshua means the deliverer or the rescuer. And that's that Hebrew name Joshua becomes Jesus in his dialect that they spoke. "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." That's kind of the heart of the story. That's the heart of this Bible text. How come? Well, you have a person who's got a broken body, and you have a person who is pushed to the margin, right? In a culture where it's every man for himself, that works great while you're strong and while you're alert. You know, it works great when you're an adult. Every man for himself. It's not so great for the little ones or the broken ones. Every man for himself is a cruel way to operate when there are small or slow individuals in the group. So he's got a broken body, he's pushed to the margins, and then he's getting shushed by everybody. You heard that. Many told him to be quiet. Many told him to pipe down. How come? Why? Why not just let him be? Crazy lady with a shopping cart. No, they tried to silence him. And not just one, but many. How come? Because of what he called Jesus, Son of David. Now you have to remember, of course, that David was the most beloved of the great kings of Israel, but David had been dead for 1,000 years. But you know the promise, you know the Christmas story, you know the prophecies that great David would have a son. Yeah, everybody says, yeah, Solomon even extended the boundaries of Israel farther than David did, so the son of David is Solomon. Yeah, and you also know that there are some psalms and there are some scriptures that say, one day, David, you shall have an heir, a great-great-great-great-great-grandson who will be king over my house forever. And that doesn't apply to Solomon. Solomon ruled for 40 years, as you know, and his kingship kind of ended in shame when it only, the next one, his son, lost the kingdom and it split into pieces. So great David's even greater son is a name that came to be held in the highest hope that one day God will send Messiah. God will send the Christ, not Solomon. God will send the kind of king we need, the kind of king who will not need to be changed or exchanged. When you talk about kings, seems like third or fourth grade stuff. You're talking about someone who first is on the hook to protect you. A king must protect his people, his citizens. And second, a king must see to providing for them. So two verbs that start with P, protect and provide. That's what a king does. It's a very rich picture if you think about it. There is an episode which is warm in the David stories. Where, by the way, where would you look in the Bible to find the David stories? Actually, there are three different books where you would find them. The book Samuel, and the book Kings, and the book Chronicles. And each of those has two. There are two Samuels. There are two kings, and there are two chronicles. The David story is a very interesting thing to dig into if you say, I'm going to do one of these 40 days of scripture reading in Advent or in Lent. If you start reading at the beginning of 1 Samuel and you read through it and get to 2 Samuel, there you'll hit in chapter 7 the promises of great David's even greater son who will rule over a kingdom and he shall reign forever and ever. That's where that comes from. So this great David's even greater son, God's number one, not a proxy serving for him here like David himself, son of Jesse, or like Solomon, but the real deal. He will come to help his people. There's a warm episode in one of those books that explains how there was a widow who was not getting justice. No one would listen to her, her circuit court, her federal court. No judge that she went to would hear her because she didn't have anything. She had no leverage. She really had no rights, did she? And finally she came to David. Finally David heard of her plight. And he had her brought before him, and he said, what is it exactly that I can do for you? So she was like in the Supreme Court, only as if there weren't nine Supreme Court justices, there was one over the top, and she came to the king, and he took care of her needs. This is what a king is supposed to do. When the blind man hears that Jesus of Nazareth is coming, he starts to cry out, Son of David! And that's why everybody tried to shush him. That's why they said, that's not right. That's not just a crazy lady with a shopping cart filled with stuff she's picked out of the bin, the Goodwill bin. That's wrong. You mustn't talk like that. That's wicked. That's, remember your catechism class? That's blasphemy to take what God does and assign it to a human being. You have to stop that. Be quiet. And the beauty of this episode is that when the blind man, broken in body, pushed to the margins and shushed by the crowd, Jesus stops when he heard, Son of David. And then he said, what David did with that widow, he said, call him. And when the man, the blind man, was brought to Jesus, couldn't see Jesus, of course. Jesus says this sentence which you don't really catch the first time you hear it. But he says, what is it that you would like me to do for you? Well, who's me? The Son of David. Great. great David's greater son. What is it exactly that I, the son of David, could do for you, my man? And he says, Rabbi, in Hebrew, the letters are R-A-V, you say Rav. Rav means great. So when you put a little suffix on that, Rabbi, that means my great one or my master, or the one, you're the master and I'm just the disciple. Rabbi, I want so much to see. One of the things you learn in the seminary, which isn't immediately obvious, I guess, when you read a piece of the scripture, is you say to you, one of the questions you ask yourself when you're writing a sermon is, what is the damnable feature present, which is so wicked or so broken that it took God himself to come down here in person in order to address it? Now, and you just have a story that can just be a silly little story in a kid's Bible, you know, in three pages of bright, splashy watercolors. It doesn't seem like there's anything damnable here at all. Except that Jesus was present at creation, wasn't he? And he knew, been in on the design of the eye. It's the number one way we interpret our world, our eyes. Of course, he's given us four other senses besides sight. Jesus knew that when the first human beings listened to another voice instead of the voice of their father and their creator, that pain and suffering and sin and struggle rushed in. We see this most clearly when Jesus stands in front of the grave of Lazarus and he just breaks down. The writer uses about three different verbs for the way that Jesus was crying at Lazarus' grave. It isn't just that he shed some tears. One of the things that the writer of John chapter 11 says is that Jesus snorted like an agitated horse. Why? What is the damnable feature of these circumstances which are just part of life, blindness, even death? Well, Jesus remembered how it was once. And Jesus feels the weakness and the brokenness of his human creatures. So when Satan comes with the temptation, why? You can say, Jesus knows. Jesus feels it. If I feel it, he feels it. He's got my flesh and blood. He's sitting at his Father's right hand. And so Jesus says, what is it exactly that I might do for you? Rabbi, I want to see. And Jesus says, your faith, your trust. Those two trains passing each other, here's Jesus and here's the blind man, and there's this one moment. And Jesus says, your trust is in the right place. The man received his sight and followed in the entourage out of Jericho. We don't know if he made the 17 miles through the hot, dry, dusty canyon land. Maybe that was a great experience for him, and maybe he was in the Palm Sunday parade himself. It certainly is not beyond possibility or imagination. So, hearing this as if for the first time, Jesus could do that? Jesus could do what only God could do. Why did he do it? Because the man recognized him as great David's even greater son. Amen. We'll speak the words of the creed that's on page 31. Please stand. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our offering prayer. Dear Savior, help me to desire not so much an abundance of earthly possessions, or that I still need something in order to be happy. Rather, an abundant life, a heart that is full, and eyes to see the needs of my neighbor. Show me how to use your gifts in such a way. Then my life will be acceptable to you and will bring thanksgiving to you from those I help, knowing that such a life will also bring happiness to me. Amen. We'll speak the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus has given us a holy supper, in which we receive his true body and blood, for the forgiveness of sins and the strengthening of faith. In this supper, we celebrate the gift of his redemption. We bear witness to the fellowship we share as confessors of the truth, and we proclaim his death until he returns. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he's blessed us with every spiritual blessing. He sends the Holy Spirit to testify that we are his children and to strengthen us when we are weak. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever. Thank you. betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Savior Jesus poured out on the cross at Calvary for the remission, the sending away from you to Jesus, all of your sin, the blood of Christ for you. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Savior shed on the cross at Calvary for the remission, the sending away from you to Jesus, all of your sin. This body and blood will strengthen and preserve you in the true faith to life everlasting. So go in peace, your sin forgiven. Remember who you are, a dear child of God on your way home to heaven. Amen. This is this is for you, poured out on the cross at Calvary for the remission, the sending away from you to Jesus all of your sin. His body and blood will strengthen and preserve you in the true faith to life everlasting. So go in peace, your sin forgiven. Remember who you are, a dear child of God on your way home to heaven. Amen. Thanks to our musician this morning. The instrument, maybe some of you remember, was given to us in Ron Husbach's name, who used to be one of our musicians. By the way, I'll just say, since I mentioned the name Husbach, circumstances have changed a little bit where Marge is, 156th and Q. There's a new director there, been there for 6 months or so. And it's way easier to see Marge now than it was when she first went in there, part of that due to the fact that Marge herself has calmed down quite a bit about being in memory care. So if anybody was missing Marge and still wanted to see her, she's still a pleasant person to talk to and enjoys guests. Let me know if you want to see her. I'll try and make that work out, or go with you if you don't want to go by yourself. Birthdays and anniversaries in the coming week is the only week on this page that the word N-O-N-E is on there. I wonder, I wasn't here last week, but I think you all know Keith and Sylvia had a big anniversary, number 60. And Ken Ondraček, Ken, did you know he just got married a year ago? He's just been married for 1 year, and his anniversary was last week. So next time you see Ken, you can say happy anniversary to him. Anybody else have an announcement? Oh, well, we should say we have the quarterly meeting today. You know, there are times in a congregation's life that are easier than others. I don't know if this is one of the more challenging ones we're on. We're just about to head into month 23 of a vacancy. The Jeskys will be moving out of the parsonage, hopefully by the middle of the month of November. You know, it's not anything. There's no crisis in any of this anywhere, but it's a change, and none of us really love change unless we get to pick it. And so, in life, I think 99 out of 100 changes you don't get to pick. So we have to spend a little time looking at each other, talking to each other, hearing each other's voices. Something we can do in our quarterly meeting shall I say, ratchet down the tension that comes during an election season. There still is some normalcy in the world. There still is a Christian church. It's not all craziness and people shouting at you. So we will say we'll just do a common prayer. Yeah, Ken?
Just a little note. I talked to Keith this morning a little bit, came here to drop off his report. Our dear Sylvia, you know how she has something to take, but she actually fell twice this weekend. So she's actually in the hospital. Keith said they're doing okay, but he dropped off his report and then be with his wife. So keep her in your prayers.
You know, they are in, Sylvia's in assisted living right now. Assisted living, which just means somebody pops in twice a day to see how you're doing. Yeah, what I'm saying is that you know what the next step is. The next step is full-time care. That would require another move. I think Sylvia's moved about 4 or 5 times in the last 6 to 9 months. So, okay, so she's at Methodist, did you say? Okay. Brenda, were you waving at me?
Yeah, I was just going to say I've been in contact with Jeannie Henderson back and forth. Yeah.
Good.
Hurricanes
good.
Over there.
Good.
And they're in Port Charlotte, that's where they bought their next fixer upper and stuff. And she said they were spared with minimal damage from both of them. So she thanks everyone for their thoughts and prayers.
Thank you for following up. I've thought of them many times, but I didn't do what you did. What I didn't do with you, Brenda. Hey, that's great. You know, if I might just say, we do have a church in Port Charlotte. Yeah, we do. Okay, so come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. Let these gifts to us be blessed. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Amen. Okay, it looks like we need some tables set up, so somebody who's got some arms and shoulders.